Sadly, and this is the truth, I personally know many African-American laity, religious, and clergy, including bishops, who based upon their own personal experiences, do not believe that their black lives matter in the Catholic Church as much as white lives matter. This is not a good situation. We must be bridge builders.
Welcome back to The World Over. That was my next guest speaking earlier this year on the subject of race in the U.S. and in the Catholic Church in the United States specifically. The division between races in this country seems to be widening. The white supremacist demonstrations in Charlottesville and the interaction between black men and police have come into renewed focus. My next guest is the Bishop of Belleville, Illinois, and he's spoken of the racial divide in the country. Here to share his thoughts on healing those divisions is Bishop Edward Braxton via satellite from Belleville. Your Excellency, thank you for being here.
I'm happy to be with you, Raymond. Thank you.
I want to start with the number of black Catholics here in the U.S., this, of course, being Black Catholic History Month. But the numbers, I was staggered to learn that there are 2.9 million U.S. black Catholics, now surpassing the population of the AME Church, the African Methodist Episcopal Church. What do those numbers tell us? And do they indicate the strength of the black Catholic experience here in the U.S.?
Well, I hope the African-American Catholic community has a true strength, but the fact that there are only 2.9 African-American Catholics, you must remember, there are nearly 70 million Catholics in the United States. Mm-hmm. And while the 2.9 million African-American Catholics is larger than the number of African-Americans in the African Methodist Episcopal Church, keep in mind that for the total African-American population of about 36 million Americans, about 5% or even lower are Catholics, and 60, 70, 80% are either mainline Protestants or traditional African-American Christian churches. So while many Catholics don't know that there are 2.9 million African-American Catholics because they don't live in Chicago, Baltimore, Washington, New York, St. Louis, New Orleans, Houston, and places where there are significant numbers, the number is still quite small. And I should say older people. They're not primarily 20-somethings and 30-somethings.
So where has the church fallen down on this issue, Your Excellency? Why has, because you said in your talk, the horizon of possibilities at Catholic U, you said, I do not believe there are any grounds for hoping the number of African-American Catholics will increase significantly in the coming generations. Indeed, the number may actually decline. Why? What are we missing?
Well, I did say that in my address on the racial divide and old wounds reopened at Catholic University of America, because the Catholic Church is a part of history, and history cannot be undone. And unfortunately, in the United States, the Catholic Church could be said to have been on the wrong side of history during the terrible events of the so-called slave trade, the capturing and buying and selling of free human beings. Mm-hmm. And we all who know history know that the Catholic Church was not an eager actor in the work to abolish human slavery. The Catholic Church did not object when Roger Taney, the Catholic Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, ruled in 1857 that African people were property and had no status. It has taken the Catholic Church a long, long time to begin to actively and aggressively work on behalf of the true dignity of all human beings in terms of the race relations in the United States. And so the fact that the Catholic Church in the 1950s began to make statements about racial justice, and more in the 1960s, of course, it is hard to undo all those years from the 1920s, 30s, 40s, and 50s, especially during the Great Migration of African Americans from the South to northern cities, when neighborhoods were segregated, schools were segregated, churches were segregated. Young men of color couldn't go to a Catholic seminary. Young women of color couldn't go to a convent and become religious sisters. And so the Catholic Church is rightly working very aggressively and has also made great strides in service in the African-American community in education, healthcare, and advocacy. But unfortunately, people have long memories, and many people are now very happy as Baptists or even as followers of Islam, and so the Catholic Church doesn't occur to them as a place to make a religious home.
So how does the church make inroads? I mean, surely 20-year-olds, 30-year-olds, Your Excellency, they are not burdened with that history. They don't really know it all that well. And when I think of Black Catholics, I think of Mother Henriette de Lille. I think of the Sisters of the Holy Family, of a Black Order in New Orleans. Because as a child, I saw those examples around me. Where is the church missing an evangelical opportunity among the Black
Well, women? I know the stories. I know the life of Henriette de Lille and the great work of the Sisters of the Blessed Sacrament, the Holy Family. But don't forget, all of those orders, for example, the Sisters of the Holy Family, that's a segregated order. It came about because they could not be in other orders. The 20-something and the 30-somethings are not aware of all of that history, but the 20-something and the 30-somethings in the Catholic Church of people of color, they are not as interested in religion any more than the people of European American background.
Right.
In all of our churches of whatever race, you don't see that many of the 20-somethings or the 30-somethings because of the great secular culture. Charles Taylor, in his book called The Secular Age, stresses the fact that in a secular age, it's not likely that people of a more youthful population, especially the educated, are going to be strongly attracted to organized, structured, institutionalized religion.
Your Excellency, that is not the story in Africa, however. And I wonder if the vibrancy of faith that we're seeing there, and even in the immigration patterns, you know, I had Africans in my parish in Virginia, and they were some of the most fervent, expressive believers in that community. Might that be a way to attract African Americans to the faith? And what are we missing here?
I don't know, Raymond. I have traveled to Africa many times, to Nigeria, to Kenya, to Uganda, to South Africa, to Benin. I've traveled extensively all through Africa, have many friends who are bishops there. I ordain priests regularly in various dioceses in Africa. Dear Cardinal Renzi from the Holy See is a good friend of mine, as is Cardinal Turkson. So I've traveled to their home dioceses. But Africa is in a very different place in its history and culture. Mm-hmm. It's in a very different place. First of all, the people of, let's say, Nigeria, there's a large Islamic population, but also a large Catholic population. But the people of Nigeria are a young church. The Catholic Church is very young in the archdiocese, let's say, of Onitsha. And so the Catholic Church is a new, vibrant seed. And so there are lots and lots of vocations to the priesthood and the religious life. But the culture is much more uniform. And the culture in Nigeria or Uganda or Kenya is partially an agrarian culture, a culture that is very comfortable with a kind of an animist tradition, a sense of God in nature. It is not influenced by this secular technological culture where the questions that are often answered by religion can now be answered by technology and science. There's a sort of a kind of a natural religious spirit amongst many of the people of Africa. And also African people in Kenya, Nigeria, Uganda, Benin, and other places, Ghana, the culture itself is structured in a way that has a kinship with the Catholic Church. So I don't think you can easily say that the vibrancy of the church in Africa, even with the immigrants coming to this country, will mean that the African-American community is going to grow significantly. I don't see the evidence for that. I've read several articles saying that, but I don't see the evidence for
that. So you are not terribly optimistic about the future of the African American community in Catholicism. I mean, that's what I'm hearing here.
Well, no, you're hearing me wrong. I'm very enthusiastic about the future of the church. I'm not enthusiastic about a significant and dramatic growth. Uh-huh. But I would say I'm not enthusiastic about a significant and dramatic growth of the Catholic Church in many communities. We see significant presence in the Hispanic community, the Vietnamese community, in those cultures that are not as dramatically influenced by the secularity and the technology of the American culture. I think the African-American Catholic community, the small number of religious brothers and sisters and priests and the small number of bishops and the small number of Catholic laity that we have, it is a vibrant community. I just spoke at the African-American Congress in Orlando, Florida this summer, and I participated in many activities in the African-American Catholic community. There's a vibrancy there, but you know, the church was not necessarily going to always be tens of millions of people. Jesus spoke of the salt, the leaven, the mustard seed. So the church can be vibrant and strong and effective and have a great impact without necessarily having huge numbers.
Okay. I want to talk for a moment before we run out of time, the issue of how to bring people together, how to overcome the racial divide and the racism we see in the community. There's been a lot of ink spilled over the last few years by bishops. You've written two pastoral letters dealing with race. I know my bishops in New Orleans have written of them. Recently, Cardinal Donald Wuerl issued his own pastoral letter entitled The Challenge of Racism Today. And the USCCB, the Bishops' Conference, now has formed an ad hoc committee to deal with racism in 2018. Your thoughts on what this might achieve and what should be contained in the forthcoming pastoral from the bishops?
Pastoral letters have no impact at all, Raymond, if nobody reads them, if nobody studies them, if nobody lives by what they contain. Brothers and Sisters to Us, published in 1979, which I helped Bishop Joe Francis and Cardinal Hickey, then Bishop Hickey, in the drafting, in the reviewing of that manuscript. Many Catholic parishes, you could print Brothers and Sisters to Us tomorrow, and 90% of the Catholics would think it was new, because it was never really studied carefully and implemented, preached from the pulpit, used in the schools, used in adult education, and it was never, many of the priorities and the challenges laid out there were never rigorously and aggressively followed up on. Have we done this? Have we done this? Have we addressed this? Have we addressed this?
I think you're right.
So the new pastoral letter will be important. I welcome it. I'm very aware of it. Any bishop who contributes something on the subject is very important. But if the people don't study it, think about it, break up into small groups and chew on it and personally appropriate it and bring it to them, to the liturgy, and pray before the Blessed Sacrament and ask the Holy Spirit to guide them, the racial divide in the United States will not become less acute. It will become more acute, which can be exacerbated in time by the vocabulary and the rhetoric of sometimes people in positions of leadership, which does not help the matter. The need to recognize the true meaning of the Incarnation. If we are Christians and we believe that the Word of God is made flesh in Jesus of Nazareth, and He redeems us all, He is the Redeemer of us all, then we see the dignity and the worth of every human being of all religious and racial backgrounds, and we don't harbor biases and prejudices, even though in the United States there is a flaw at the foundation because of the horror, the original sin of this country,
the sin of slavery,
of the slave trade.
Bishop Braxton, I agree with you. One of the blessings of living in a place like New Orleans, and I didn't experience this in Virginia or New York where I've lived before. In New Orleans, blacks and whites eat together, we worship together, we go to parades together. There is an interaction, and that proximity makes racism a lot harder when you have to live and be around each other, because there ends up being no other anymore. It's, you're all in it together. That is not the experience in the segregated North and other places I've lived.
No, the culture of New Orleans is unique, I would say, though I lived, as you may know, for several years in Lake Charles, which isn't far away. When I was the bishop of Lake Charles, I'm originally from Chicago, however, and Chicago has been and continues to be one of the most segregated cities in the country, unfortunately. And if you don't have real contact with people of different backgrounds, it's the same as if you don't know any Jewish people.
Correct.
You don't know any Islamic people. You presume that all Muslims are terrorists because you have no knowledge firsthand of the tremendously gifted people in the Islamic community. So I don't think we can expect some quick fix. The key to me is bringing people together in various forms of conversations. Our American society is still very separated.
I agree.
Few African-American families and European-American families sit down for dinner together, go on vacations together, travel together, pray together. Our churches are still largely segregated.
Yes.
Contact and genuine sharing with an openness to true conversion. True conversion.
Thank you very much. Great to hear you, Bishop Edward Braxton. I hope you'll join us again.
Thank you very much, Raymond. I'm happy to be with you.